In this tutorial, we're continuing the analysis of this table. So far, we've analyzed the top surface, which we said was made of wood, subject to a large force, 500 pounds, applied on this back edge. Those are the results I'll show you in just a moment. What we're going to do in this tutorial is add a second part, which is this C channel across the back edge, designed to support that high load, and we'll see how things change. Here's the result that we got last time. We found very high stresses. We're looking at von Mises stresses here. Very high stresses in the back corners with the load applied up at the front here. I don't really believe those. I think those are an artifact of the boundary conditions. So we'll be revisiting them later on. Looking at deflection under this loading condition, remember all around this edge, we fixed the nodes so they couldn't translate. So we got a large amount of deflection, almost 10 inches here in the center where the force was applied. That seems pretty high, and I think would probably damage the wood. So what we're going to do is go and look at a slightly different condition where we add this C channel. So I need to add a C channel part. Remember that process. I'm going to name the part. I make sure that it's a wire part. Draw a line. I have to notice it wants to continue drawing, so I either click escape or I hit the right mouse button and cancel, or I could have hit the red X at the bottom. I then need to dimension my line. This is going to go all the way across the bottom. If you remember from last time, that's a 48-inch span across that long side of the table. Okay, cancel out of this. Done. I've got my part. Pretty straightforward part. But we get some interesting things here in the property module. What we're going to want to do is create a new material because this is a steel part. Give it a name, choose mechanical elasticity elastic. For linear static analysis, that's sufficient. For an isotropic elastic material, Young's modulus for steel is 30E6 and the Poisson's ratio is 0.3. Then I define a section. I want to make sure that it's a beam and that it's beam type. The beam category also has truss types, but they can only take tension and compression. I can choose my material steel that I just defined, and I also need to choose a profile, but I don't have one yet. The profile is the cross-section shape. So I can either come back here and choose create profile, or you see this is actually a button, create beam profile. I can do it right there. Box, pipe, circular, none of these are actually C channels, so I have to go to an arbitrary channel. An arbitrary cross section, rather, is just one where I can put in multiple points and the thicknesses between the points. You have to do a little bit of upfront work and figure out the coordinates of the points. First off, point one, I'm going to set that to be 0.3125 for the x coordinate and 0.3125 for the y coordinate. Tab on down to point two. That's going to have an x coordinate of 0 and a y coordinate of 0.3125. And the thickness there is 0.125, so an eighth of an inch thick. Now, to get another point to show up, I hit enter. Okay, we have a defined C channel profile, and it's part of our C channel section. Now I need to assign that to my beam. Section C channel came up automatically because it was the only type that was appropriate for a wire. Click OK, so I've assigned the section. Because this is a beam, I have one more step in the property module. I have to assign a beam orientation. Select the regions that you're going to assign the beam orientation. That's the region. Done. Okay, so what's going on here? Enter the approximate N1 direction tangent vectors are shown. So the basic idea is we want to say for the profile that we created, I've got a 1 and a 2 axis in the local coordinate system. The origin of this coordinate system is going to sit right on this wire, and the 3 axis, or the Z axis locally, is going to be what these red arrows represent. They call it the tangent vector. So I want my C channel, because of how I defined it, I want it to be open in the upward direction on the screen, which is the positive y-axis globally. So what it's asking me here is, the local coordinate or the local axis 1, where does it point in the global system? So the one axis was pointing towards the open part of the C, so I want that in the positive Y. So this is now a vector that's pointing in the direction of the local one coordinate. So it's 0, 1, 0 in my case. And you can see that's pointing in the positive Y direction like I wanted it. I click OK to confirm. I need to cancel out of this. So I've defined them, but what does that mean? How do I confirm that this is reasonable? And here's a way that you can do it. If you go to View and do Part Display Options, down near the bottom, you can Render Beam Profiles. Click OK. And now I've got some thickness here. And if I rotate my view, I've got a C channel. And it's open in the Y direction, which is exactly what I want. Notice also that I've got some perspective on here. That's kind of nice at times, but you can turn it off if you don't like it. Now I'm looking straight on. It's like a cross section rather than looking down a long part. It's up to you how you want to view your geometry. Okay, that completes the property module. So on to assembly. We need to add an instance. And I'm going to say okay. Okay, so at this point, I know that I want to relocate this C channel so that it's down here on the edge of my part. But I'm going to give you a little bit of a hint. Don't do it yet. Go to your interaction module, because I want to attach these two things together. I want them to stay together throughout my analysis. So that's what I define in interaction. If I do that now, while I can grab both pieces independently, it's a much quicker operation. Otherwise, I'm going to have to separate them after I already join them. So I recommend doing the interactions first and then moving the parts where you want them to be. An interaction technically is something that can change between two parts. So for instance, parts come into contact or they leave contact. That's a classic interaction. What we want is actually something that remains fixed throughout the analysis. That's what we're calling a constraint. A tie constraint is a common constraint, and that's the one that makes the most sense here. I'm going to continue. Some comments about notation. So the master is the set of nodes that when they move, the slave has to follow them. You can choose in most cases any set to be the master and the other set to be the slave. The reason that we have this concept of master versus slave is that there are times that you want to have multiple parts that are connected to each other, and the slave nodes can only be slave to one other master. So you have to sometimes do a tiered approach in order to get all of your parts connected. In this case, I'm going to go ahead and choose a node region, and I'm going to define this back edge here, again using shift because I broke it into two pieces last time. That's going to be my set of master nodes. And then for my slave, I'm going to choose the C channel that I'm adding. Leave position tolerance for computed defaults. That's going to force you to get the nodes near each other in order to tie them, and that's a good thing. I recommend turning off adjusting the slave nodes, because if your slave nodes are too far away, this will just cause major distortion of your mesh. And if they're close enough, then it doesn't have to happen anyway. So your best bet is to turn that off and use computed default up here. So you say okay. Now these little open circles tell me that those things are connected to each other. Now I can go back to the assembly and move my instance, translate instance. I'm going to take this C channel and translate it. Okay, again, paying attention to the prompts, select a start point for the translation vector. You're going to define a vector that points from where you currently are to where you want to be. So for instance, if I want to move, say, negative 5 in the y direction, I would choose the start point as 0, 0, 0, so just hit enter, and then do a negative 5 for my y component of the second point. And that moves me 5 down. And I say OK, and I'm done. That, of course, is not what I want to do in this way case. So let me go back and do it again. Select the instance to translate. Grab that one. What I want to do is actually move this point over to there, or conversely, this point over to there. And so this translation vector makes a lot of sense here, because I can pick a point. That's my start point. And the lower corner of the table, that's my endpoint. Boom, that looks good. So I click OK. Now I can't even see that it's here, but I can remedy that by assembly display options and turning on the beam profile. And now if I rotate this around, I'll be able to see that I've actually added the appearance of the beam cross section there, and it's oriented the way that I want. So this is a good visual confirmation. So what else? Step. I did that previously. We already have a step, static general. No reason to change that. Interaction we've dealt with. The load should be unchanged. The mesh. I have not done a mesh on my C-channel yet. So I'm going to go to the part, the C-channel part, and you can see it's pink, meaning it's not meshed. I'm going to seed it, first of all. Let's change view. And I'm going to go ahead and change, turn off the appearance of the beam profiles. So it looks like a wire again. I'll go with the default size. That seed looks fine. And I'm going to now mesh the part. Yes, and it turned blue because it's now meshed. So I've got a mesh on everything. I'll go to the job module and let me create a new job that's corresponding to my new analysis rather than tabletop wood. Now, I will point out, I just realized that I made an error early on. My first step should have been to create a new model. I'm going to click continue here, create my job, and then I'm going to show you what I mean. If I go back to my tree over here, I've been adding things to my tabletop wood model. That was not my intention. What I intended to do, and this is what I always recommend you do when you're building on an existing model, make a copy first. And I meant to call this tabletop full as my new model. You see, now I've got both models there. Unfortunately, tabletop wood has been modified. So this what I made a mistake. I'd have to go and undo a lot of steps that I'm not going to bother with here. But if you get in that practice of copying your model as you build things onto it, you'll always be able to return to where you were much simpler. All right, so I'm in the job module. Let's take a look at that job that I just created. And now I submit. And I monitor. Always remember to do the monitoring while it's running. And in particular, look at your warnings tab. Something comes up here. In a warning, it's able to complete the analysis. As we can see, it has just completed it. But this might tell you useful information. You always want to make sure you understand the warnings. These warnings show up very often when we're doing tide constraints or contact definitions. And these two I'm familiar with, and I can tell you that they are not important. The first one is just warning me that if possible, I should use a surface definition rather than a node definition for my tide constraint. And then the second one is telling me that if the parts are not close to each other, then there's going to be some problem with that tide constraint. So they're just general warnings rather than specific ones. Dismiss, results. Here's my part. Let's check out stresses. Wow, everything is blue. Okay, we'll take a look at that again in a moment. Let's look at you for my deflection. So my deflection looks similar, but look at the magnitude over here. 2.63 inches rather than 9.9. And then I can go and do the query and just verify that. Probe values, nodes, hover over that node. Yep, 2.63. All right, so what was going on here with my stress plot? Why did everything turn blue? Well, think about that for just a moment. While you're doing that, I'll pull up the ODV display options. Turn on my beam profile. So you can see that's easier to see the beam now in that view. Okay, so what's going on there? The reason this all turned blue is that the stresses in the softer or less stiff part are less than the stresses in the stiff part. In this case, the C channel that I added is much stiffer than the wood. So the wood all appears blue because it's in this first category of stress. The higher stresses are present only in the C channel. So what if I want to focus in on the wood? Well, you got a couple of options. So you can turn off the display of one of the parts. The way that you do that is you go over to Tools, Display Group. I want to create a display group, choose Part Instances. I'm going to choose my C channel and I'm going to remove it from the display. As soon as I do that, the stress plot is now based on the remaining part that's in there, which is the wood, and we can see we're still getting some peak stresses in those corners. So I still want to look at the boundary conditions. So if I want to add that part back in, again here in the display group, I just say add, and I've got both parts back in. Okay, that's it for this tutorial. Next time we're going to look at adding in the full frame.